Respected seniors and my dear friends, I am today going to focus basically on what a resident needs to know in MRI. You know, because I will not go into, you know, details of each pathology. I will go into things which I feel an orthopedic resident does not know, or what he feels, you know, difficult to say. I will focus on what sequences of MRI are essential for orthopedics, how do you identify them, what do you say in your exam. This is basically my entire focus of. Yes, yes. That is the entire focus of mine. What is T1, what is T2, what do we see in each? This is my entire focus for today. Okay. Now, musculoskeletal imaging, as you all know, as the technology is advancing, it is becoming more and more confused. You all know this. Okay. Let's see now. Now, let's focus one by one on each thing that you will see. When I'm imaging, you know, you have to see a radiologist as a counter physician, okay? I'm a physician like you. So as you see a patient, similarly I see a MRI film, okay? So I look at it step by step. I look at the skeleton, musculature, joints, associated soft tissue structures. In the bones, you know, you have to understand, in MRI, we are going to comment on marrow, cortex. In the muscles, we are going to talk of bellies, tendons, their origins and their insertions. In the joint, we are going to talk of articular surfaces, including the articular cartilage, joint capsule, synovium, related bursae, okay, ligaments, articular disc, labra and menisci, and we also look at the neurovascular bundles side by side. Now, this is what you know conventionally. Earlier, radiology was all about X-rays, tomography, fluoroscopy and injection arthrography. Today, it is all about CT scan, MRI, ultrasound, radionucleotide imaging and DEXA scan. My focus would be predominantly on MRI. Now, you all know, firstly, in any patient, you have an orthopedic patient, you first get a plain X-ray done. It is usually the first choice and it is relatively cheap, easy to do, it is good for the cortical bone, but it does not tell you anything about the soft tissue, it is not cross-sectional. Similarly for CT, you know, we have advantage of it being cross-sectional, but it is not multiplanar. I hope you know, we can see only in one plane, axial plane, but we can do multiplanar reformation with CT, but we are not doing actual multiplanar imaging. I will show you all the examples. And similarly, some people have nowadays do a CT arthrogram. They inject an intra-articular dye and then they do a scan. So they can see the structures which were earlier invisible to CT with the CT arthrogram. CT, we can do reconstructions like this, but these are reconstructions, okay? Do you follow this? We are not actually acquiring the images in coronal or in the sagittal plane. We are acquiring the images in the transverse plane and we are reconstructing them. MRI is different. Now, MRI, we all know, it gives us unparalleled visualization of the muscles, joints, bone marrow. We get good contrast, we have different kind of images which you don't understand. What is T1, what is T2, what is proton density, what is stir? I'll show you all. Okay? But one message that I want you to understand, MRI is not good for the cortical bone. If you want to look at the cortex of the bone, probably CT is better. The way I remember this is M for marrow, M for MRI, C for cortex, C for CT. Let's see, I'll show you. Now let's see how MRI is being used in the past and in the future. This is the kind of MRI machine which you were sending your patients to a few years back. This is called an open MRI. Open. Can you see this? You see the difference? This is the current day MRI that is being used in most of the hospitals. And this is the open MRI. Do you understand this? What you write? Whenever you have a patient which is claustrophobic, you say, get an open MRI. And this is how open MRI looks like. This is a closed MRI. The disadvantage of this kind of MRI was, this is a low strength magnet. Low strength magnet, that means this is a 0.3 Tesla, 0.3, 0.5 Tesla. Maximum that you have in this kind of a MRI is 0.3, 0.5 Tesla. This is a superconducting MRI, which is currently being used in most of the locations, which has a strength of around 1.5 to 3 Tesla, 1.5 to 3 Tesla. Now, this is something which I want you to look at. This is the future. A patient getting a MRI done in most of the places, now they are starting this in India as well. This is a patient is sitting. Open from the front, weight-bearing position, he can extend the spine, flex the spine, see how the vertebrae are moving with flexion, with extension, image the joint in the position of the pain. This is called as upright MRI. Okay, so MRI has evolved from open MRI machine, but this was a low strength magnet. You could not take thinner sections with this. This was taking longer time. This is faster. You can take very thin sections, and this is at the position of the pain, weight bearing, flexion, extension, dynamic, everything is possible with this. Okay, let's see now. Now, whenever you do a MRI, whenever you get an MRI done, orthopedic surgeon or a resident in particular, sometimes he get perplexed with the number of films that we give them. You know, you get an X-ray done, you get one film. You get an MRI done, you get many films. Okay, these are because in MRI we do different sequences. The basic most two sequences that everybody should know in MRI, in every case we do two sequences. One is called as T1, other is called as T2. One is T1, other is T2. T1 is good for anatomy. Can you remember this? T1 is good for anatomy. Whenever we want to look at the marrow, the fat content within the marrow and within the muscles, we do T1. Second thing you need to remember is, whenever you do a contrast enhanced scan, do you follow this? You can do MRI plain or you can give a contrast, especially if you have a tumor, synovitis, synovial inflammation, anything you want to see with contrast, it is a T1 sequence. Do you follow this? Post contrast sequences are also T1, and anatomy oriented sequences are T1. I'll show you. Okay. Now, can you see this spine? Can you see this cervical spine? Can you tell me, is it T1 or T2? It is a sagittal image. Is it T1 or T2?
T1.
How do we know?
Water is white.
Very good. Now please look at the CSF. Can you look at the CSF surrounding the cord? If the CSF is dark, it is a T1 weighted image. In T2 weighted image, CSF is white. Water is white on T2 weighted images. Water is dark on T1 weighted images. Look at the marrow, okay, the cord. Anatomical details are better seen on T1 weighted images. On T2 weighted images, fluid is bright, and most of the pathological processes like tumors, infection, injury are highlighted on T2 due to increased fluid content. Now this is T2. Are you able to follow this? CSF is white, clear, no doubt. Similarly, can you see these end plates? Dark on T1, white on T2, okay, like fluid. So most of the pathologies like inflammation, infection, tumors, you will see them as white on T2, dark on T1. Okay. Now this is how a gray scale of MRI looks like. Now let's see now. This is a T1 weighted MR images. If I see something like this white, what is white? Marrow. Marrow is white. Can you see the subcutaneous fat? This is white. Blood, normally you don't see blood other than hematrosis. It is also white on T1. Contrast, whenever I inject gadolinium, it appears white on T1. Now let's see, black. If you see anything black on MRI, what is this? Cortical bone. Can you see cortex? Is black on MRI. Can you see tendons, patellar tendon? Dark on MRI. Ligaments, dark. Blood vessels also, they look like flow voids. Have you heard the word flow void? They are dark on both T1 and T2. Flowing blood, flow void, we call them flow void. Why is this important? Sometimes you have a tumor and you want to look for vascular encasement. You see the vessel flow void being encased by the tumor. Intermediate signal, gray, muscles, hyaline cartilage, fluid, they all look gray on a T1 weighted images. Now, I've drawn a table for you to understand. Fat is bright on T1, less bright on T2. Subacute hemorrhage, proteinaceous fluid, they are bright on both. Fluid is dark on T1. White on T2, fibrous tissue, cortical bone, air, chronic hemorrhage, they are all dark on all sequences. Okay, do you remember this? Fibrous tissue like cortex, tendon, ligament, they are dark on all sequences. Fluid is dark on T1, white on T2, fat is white on both. Okay, now I'll give you just the basic phenomena that you need to know. Whenever I'm doing an MRI for an MSK patient, I want to see the anatomy, I want to see abnormal fluid or abnormal enhancement. I'll show you. Now, we use some sequences like T1, GRE stands for gradient echo and proton density. Please remember these three sequences, whenever you look at the anatomy, you look at these sequences. T1, GRE, proton density. And whenever I look for fluid, fluid means edema is also fluid. Marodima. So how do I look at inversion recovery, which is what you call as STIR? Have you heard of this STIR? STIR. Many of the MRI reports you will see this STIR, short tau inversion recovery sequence. STIR. This is inversion recovery, and we look use a PD fat sat image. Okay, and we can use contrast both intraarticularly and intravenously so that we can define the pathology better. Okay. Okay. This is T1. Now, how do you know this is T1? Image of the pelvis. Can you see marrow? Fat is white on T1. Bladder is dark. That means it is T1 because urine is like fluid, water. It is dark. This is T1. Okay. So, this see. Do you see this? Okay. Now, proton density. Sometimes you know non-radiologists don't understand this. What does this proton density sequence mean? While for MSK imaging, proton density is very important. All the knee MR, everything, they will have a proton density image. Meniscus, they all seem good on proton density. Why do we do this? Because you know this, you have to understand. I'll give you a clue how to remember. The bladder is not as dark as the T1, not as white as the T2. Intermediate. Proton density, in fact, is the intermediate sequence between T1 and T2. Now you can recognize with the film. If this density, you know, I'll just go back for you. See how dark it is. Okay, how dark it is. T1. Now you see gray. Okay. Now we can give. I already told you. Whenever we have to give contrast, we do a T1 sequence. Now in your mind, you might be having a question. On T1, I told you fat is white. Okay. On T1, the I told you the contrast is also white. So specially for post contrast sequences, we use T1 fat sat sequences. T1 fat sat. You would read this word in many of the MRI reports. They say we have used T1 fat sat post contrast images. What does it mean? I have suppressed the signal of the fat so that I can see only the contrast. Now you can see marrow is all black. They have all suppressed the fat. Only you can see joint being distended by gadolinium. Do you understand this? For post contrast sequences in musculoskeletal system, you prefer T1 fat sat images, because if you suppress fat, then only you can see contrast. This is how a gradient equal sequence looks like. And can you see cartilage, articular cartilage? Articular cartilage is well seen on a gradient echo sequence. Now, sequences which we use for detecting fluid, one is proton density fat sat. Now, can you see how do you know the fat is saturated here? Can you see marrow was white in the earlier sequence that I showed you? Now, marrow has become dark. If there is, okay, I'll show you. Now, this is another kind of fat suppression, which is called as inversion recovery, which I already told you, which was STIR, short tau inversion recovery sequence. Now in this sequence, we suppress the signal of the normal marrow. If there is any pathology, it will shine out. And can you see the bladder shining out? Any fluid will shine out. In STIR, any fluid will shine. So this is how we look localize bone lesions. If we do T2, okay, I'll explain. T1 can see anatomy, T2 can see pathology. Now T2 fat is bright. If I suppress the fat, the pathology shines. This is STIR. Do you understand this now? STIR is a kind of T2 fat sat image. T2 fat sat image. Now, should I explain again or is it okay? Okay. Now, I already told you this is a tumor. And if I had not done fat sat, the marrow would also be white. Tumor would be white after contrast. You cannot differentiate. So we use T1 fat sat post gadolinium to evaluate tumors. Another thing that the orthopedic surgeon needs to know is gadolinium. Why do I advise a post contrast MRI? You advise when you are looking at a cystic versus solid tumor. You want to differentiate tumor from the areas of non-enhancing necrosis. You want to differentiate soft tissue edema from the focal abscess formation. You want to, contrast is particularly useful to differentiate enhancing epidural scar tissue from non-enhancing disc material. Very important in post-operative spinal cases. And it is helpful in locating cord lesions and intradural extramedullary lesions. I'll show you how. Can you see the finding in this case? Can you appreciate the finding in this case? Now I'll show you. This is the vertebral body. This is the canal. Can you see the neural canal here is widened? Now I give contrast to this patient. Immediately, can you see the tumor getting white? Tumor is getting white. This is. Can you see a dumbbell shaped tumor here? Neurofibroma. So contrast helps us in localizing spinal tumors. Tumor which was invisible earlier, if I give contrast, it shines up. Now this is how MRI knee looks like. This is a sagittal image. This is the coronal. This is the axial image. Okay, I'll show you something very interesting. How do we look at MRI? We don't look at static images. We look at the entire series. Okay? Now, can you tell me this is medial meniscus or lateral meniscus? Is this medial meniscus or lateral meniscus? How do you know? Now, how do I, as a radiologist, know? Normally, earlier when I was training, I used to look at the fibula. If the fibula is seen on the side, I would say this is lateral or this is medial. Now I know. This medial side is triangular. Medial fib is triangular. If on a cut section, medial side of the tibia is triangular, this is the meniscal bow tie. Have you heard this? Myself, bow tie. Okay? Now I go forward. Okay? Now I go forward. Okay? This is the posterior cruciate ligament, I hope. You know, you all know this. This is the anterior cruciate ligament. Okay? Give me one second. Okay. Now you see, the lateral side is more quadrangular. Sometimes on a single image, I'm not sure if it is medial or lateral. Please remember the medial tibial condyle is more triangular on a cut section. Lateral side is more quadrangular. So even if I don't see fibula, I don't get confused. I know this is lateral meniscus. This is how a MRI of a shoulder looks like, coronal, axial. Now, please remember, whenever we do MRI of the shoulder, we take oblique coronal scan, or oblique coronal oblique scan. So why do we take oblique? Because we have to image in the plane of the supraspinatus. We take the scans perpendicular to the glenoid, parallel to the glenoid. These are called as oblique scans. Okay, so don't get confused if they say this is how acromion clavicle supraspinatus looks like on a MR. This is the neurovascular bundle of the shoulder. This is humerus scapula. Okay, this is how glenoid is seen. This is the biceps tendon, clavicle, acromion clavicle joint, supraspinatus, infraspinatus. Okay, I'll be very quick. Clavicle, acromion, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, coracoid process, subscapularis. Okay, this is a wrist MR. Now, with the MR, we can look at the ankle ligaments as well. This is the anterior telofibular ligament. This is the posterior telofibular ligament. This is the deltoid ligament. Deltoid ligament is normally seen as striations. Sometimes in a tear, we see just this loss of striations. This is the Achilles tendon tear. Can you see the gap which has come in the area of the Achilles tendon? This is the Achilles tendon tear. Now, MRI is very useful to look at the occult fractures. Sometimes on an X-ray, you may not pick up a fracture which is immediately shown on a MR. Can you see this fracture line seen on a fracture in a hip MR? This X-ray, sometimes this is very common indication for MR where we are not sure of the scaphoid fracture while it shines on a MR. Now I'll show you something which we have learned. Can you see this is T1? The fracture and the surrounding edema is looking as dark. Okay. Now can you see this is a stir image, fat set? Now the edema, the bruise is shining. Okay. Now you understand, T1 is anatomy, a pathology are dark on T1, white on T2. When I use fat set T2, pathology shine through. This is a fat set T2. And we see surrounding fluid also shining. Fractures are well picked up on CT as well. Another occult fracture. MRI can pick up osteochondritis desiccans 2 minutes. We can pick up a supraspinatus tear. Okay, this is seen on a SAG section, supraspinatus tear. Meniscal tear. This is how a bucket handle tear of meniscus looks like. This is called as a double PCL sign, double PCL, okay. ACL tear. Now, in the end, I'll conclude. Earlier what happened, when MRI was invented, people started to say, array, MRI is not useful for bones. We should do CT. You must have heard this in your medical schools. We should do CT. MRI, bone is black. We can't see anything. Now, in between, people started to say, we will be able to find only the grade 3 meniscal tear and full thickness rotator cuff tears on MRI. Now we have more things available with us. I will leave you with an idea what we can do now. We can even do spectroscopy. We can know what the tissue is concerned of. Now in a rotator cuff tear, whenever my orthopedic surgeon sends the MRI to me, he says, don't only comment on the tear, tell me the status of the muscle as well. If it is atrophied, I will think differently. If it has, if the muscle belly has fat in it, it means it has atrophied. So now earlier we could not quantify. Now we have spectroscopy as well, which can quantify the amount of fat which is there in the muscle belly, and it can help us in quantifying the things. So things are changing, and MRI is going to offer you more and more information in the future. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you.